Hi, I'm Andy Howard, an applications engineer with Keysight ESOF EDA. I'm the developer of the load pull design guide in Keysight's Advanced Design System software. Load pull is an important step in the design of power amplifiers. It helps you see what key specifications like output power, efficiency, and gain could be attained from a device and determine the optimal load impedance. I'm going to show how to set up and run simple load pull simulations and examine the results. We will run load pull on a Cree GaN device at 10 GHz with the objective of delivering greater than 20 watts or 43 dBm while maximizing PAE. We'll see how the bias point affects performance and examine trade-offs. First, I'll briefly cover load pull basics. Then I'll show a sequence of load pull simulations and results during which we will adjust several parameters to obtain better performance from the device. At the end, I'll show you how to download a workspace and application note that shows a variety of additional load pull simulations of the same device. Okay, let's get started. In load pull, you sweep the load impedance presented to a device and measure key performance specifications. The resulting performance data, whether measured with test equipment or simulated using a nonlinear device model, is plotted on a Smith chart with contours of constant performance. From the load pull contours and data, you can see pretty clearly what impedance to present to your device and what performance you can expect. The power delivered to the load really depends on the load impedance. Let me briefly illustrate this. This is a simple amplifier block diagram. These are the FET's DC IV curves with a DC bias point. When the input signal is low, and I'm assuming this is a large signal, unlike a small signal which won't change the current much, the FET conducts less current than the DC bias current, so the AC component tends to flow into the load this way. When the input signal is high, the FET wants to conduct more current than the DC bias current, so the AC component tends to flow from the load this way. At low frequencies, where parasitics can be neglected, the power the FET delivers to the load for a given bias point and input signal amplitude depends on the load resistance. Here, I've added the drain current plotted versus the drain voltage through the full cycle of the input sinusoid. To maximize power delivered to the load, we would like to have large swings in both voltage and current about the bias point. We can see how the drain current versus drain voltage curve varies as we sweep the load resistance on the Smith chart. This is the simplest load pull. If the load resistance is too low, the current swing reaches its limits while the voltage swing is low, so the power delivered is lower than it could be. If the load resistance is too high, the voltage swing reaches its limits while the current swing is low, so again the power delivered is lower than it could be. You want a load that enables both high voltage and current swings. While contours at low frequency might look like this, at RF and microwave frequencies, parasitics become significant and the optimal load moves off the real axis. When setting up a load pull, the first thing we need to specify is the range of load impedances to sweep or pull. And here I am showing a sweep of the real and imaginary parts of the load impedance, which is good if you think the optimal load will be near a short circuit. We also need to specify other things like the bias voltages, which will determine the bias current and over what fraction of the input cycle the device will conduct, and the source impedance, frequency, and power. But you also need to specify the harmonic impedances, which become more important the further into compression the device is being driven. I'm going to show how to run the simplest load pull, which has a sweep of the real and imaginary parts of the load impedance at the fundamental at a single input power. I recommend this step before moving on to a power sweep or other load pull simulations because it allows you to quickly zoom in on the optimal load region of the Smith chart. How do we simulate load pull? This simulation setup is from the load pull design guide. I've replaced the sample device with a Cree GaN device, set the bias voltages for Class A operation, the source frequency, and the available source power. By default, the impedance at the fundamental is swept with the harmonic loads fixed, but we can easily switch this to a load pull of the second or third harmonic. We also need to specify the source impedance at the fundamental and the second and third harmonics, and we specify the ranges of the real and imaginary parts of the impedance. Initially, you may want to sample a fairly large region of the Smith chart to see roughly where the optimal load is. This shows the region of the Smith chart that we sample initially. This data display page shows power delivered versus PAE, contours, and data corresponding to a load selected by the marker. The power added efficiency is quite low. This is likely due to driving the device well below compression and using a suboptimal source impedance. Let's refine the sampled loads to be closer to the optimum and set the source impedance to be the complex conjugate of the input impedance. This shows the smaller region of the Smith chart to be sampled. Now we see a substantial improvement in output power and PAE. Now we will refine the sample region again and increase the available source power. This shows the smaller region to be sampled. Note that here I have changed the Smith chart reference impedance from 50 to 10 ohms. Increasing the available source power to 30 dBm, we get greater than 50% PAE. Potentially better performance could be obtained by sweeping the second and third harmonic impedances. Pretty quickly, we have attained good results and we have determined the optimal region of the Smith chart to sample. At this point, I want to show performance trade-offs you could get by changing the bias point. This plot shows power delivered versus PAE for the original Class A bias point. If we change the gate bias to -3 volts, so the device is nearly off for small input signals, you get these results. This shows a clear improvement in PAE, but the output power and gain have dropped. If we now increase the source power from 30 to 32 dBm, we get these results. So far, we have run simulations with a fixed source power, so it is not obvious how far into compression the device is operating. By adding a power sweep, we can see the gain response. This is with the original Class A bias point. And this is with the gate bias at -3 volts. We now have much higher PAE, but with significant gain expansion. You could choose a bias point in between these two extremes. In this video, I've shown how to set up and run a simple load pull and interpret the results. Load pull can also help you make design trade-offs and examine performance sensitivity due to the load. There are many additional load pull simulation capabilities available, such as sampling a circular or rectangular region, plotting ACPR and EVM contours, investigating harmonic impedances, etc. These are included in the workspace I used. You may download the workspace and a PDF document that explains it in detail by clicking the link in the text description associated with this video, or by directly using the URL link shown. Thank you for watching.